Good morning. We are so glad that you are here on a Sunday morning, bright and early. If you would, stand with us as we join this morning to sing to Him, "I Found a Friend Who Is All to Me." Lift your voice and worship with us this morning. Join as we sing, "I Found a Friend Who Is All to Me. His love is ever true. Saved one of these days, He's going to come back and take us home to live with Him for all eternity. What an incredible opportunity that is going to be for us. Sing this with us this morning. These are the days of Elijah.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. Though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord." Behold, He comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. Till salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of behold. Behold, He comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. Come.
There's no God like Jehovah. Sing that, church.
There's no God like Jehovah. There is 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 no God like Jehovah. Behold, He comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion still salvation comes.
Hey, Good morning. Thank you for being here today. If you will, during the course of our service, please take time and fill out your connection card. That would mean a whole lot to us. At the end of the service, we'll give you a chance to give it back to us when the offering plate passes in front of you. You are here today for a very special service. I can't wait for us to get deeper into it. We're going to be doing something that's a little bit unique, trying to get one main point across. And as we begin in through the process, I want you to see if you can pick out what that point is, okay? Through the music, through the videos, through the spoken word, through the reading of God's word, and then through the message. Will you please pay attention and pick out what the main point of our time today is, all right? Take a moment now and welcome people around you.
Small boats were also with him, and a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling, but he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" Then he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" And they feared exceedingly, and said to one another, "Who can this be, that even the wind and the sea obey him?"
2 Kings 6, 8 through 18. When the king of Aram was at war with Israel, he would confer with his officers and say, "We will mobilize our forces at such and such a place." But immediately Elisha, the man of God, would warn the king of Israel, "Do not go near that place, for the Arameans are planning to mobilize their troops there." So the king of Israel would send word as to the place indicated by the man of God. Time and again, Elisha warned the king so that he would be on the alert there. The king of Aram became very upset over this. He called his officers together and demanded, "Which one of you is the traitor? Who has been informing the king of Israel of my plans?" "It's not us, my lord the king," one of the officers replied. "Elisha, a prophet in Israel, tells the king of Israel even the words you speak in the privacy of your bedroom." "Go and find out where he is," the king commanded, "so I can send troops to seize him." And the report came back, "Elisha is at Dothan." So one night, the king of Aram sent a great army with many chariots and horses to surround the city. When the servant of the man of God got up early the next morning and went outside, there were troops, horses, and chariots everywhere. "Oh, sir, what will we do now?" the young man cried to Elisha. "Don't be afraid," Elisha told him, "for there are more on our side than on theirs." Then Elisha prayed, "Oh, Lord, open his eyes and let him see." The Lord opened the young man's eyes, and when he looked up, he saw that the hillside was filled with chariots of fire and horses. As the Aramean army advanced toward him, Elisha prayed, "Oh Lord, please make them blind." So the Lord struck them with blindness, as Elisha had asked.
We hope that our eyes are opened to see an almighty and a powerful God whom we serve. Sing that little chorus, "Open the eyes of my heart, Lord."
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see. Of my heart, Lord, open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Your power and love as we sing, "Holy, holy, holy." Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see.
story of Daniel is one that's always intrigued and amazed Christians throughout the history of time. But if you really look at it, I mean, today we have the internet. We have ways of looking at wild animals, wild beasts. Many of you have probably even seen short video clips of how savage these animals can actually be. And to be put in the place, in a pit, I mean, to really think about that is a scary thought. To be surrounded by wild, hungry animals. And I say hungry because if you look in verse 24 of Daniel chapter 6, there was a few men that were trying to get Daniel in trouble. They wanted Daniel to be hurt and taken away because they knew he was right and they were jealous. So they made everything possible to fool the king, and they did for a while. And Daniel was thrown into the lion's den, but immediately after he's taken out, and King Darius says, "Daniel, are you still alive?" And it's amazing. He says, "God sent his angel last night. I mean, I wish I could have, part of me wishes I wasn't there, but part of me would have liked to see what Daniel saw." He said, "God sent his angel to be here with me." And I know these lions were desperately hungry because verse 24 says, "And the king gave the command, and they brought those men who had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den of lions, them and their children and their wives. And the lions overpowered them and broke all their bones in pieces before they ever came to the bottom of the den." These guys didn't even make it to the ground floor when they were gone. Bones and all. But there's a verse in Isaiah that talks about God in our hardest moments. He's actually there, listen to this, fluffing our pillow, making us comfortable, protecting us in the most difficult times. And that's exactly what we see God doing for Daniel at this incredible time of desperate need for help. God was there to protect, because he is our protector.
Well, and even before, we see a great story developing of three Hebrew children as they were brought out of their homes and brought into a different land and a different place where they didn't know, they didn't understand it, and yet they were trying to obey and follow God. And here's these three men and not knowing what's going on. But as time has passed, we find these three young men in a specific time in history where the king of that land, Nebuchadnezzar, builds this huge, huge statue of gold and commands everybody that at the sound of the trumpets and all the flutes and all the music, that everybody should kneel down and bow and worship that idol. Therefore also worshiping King Nebuchadnezzar. But these three Hebrew men, knowing that there is one true God, were in a process of making a decision whether to follow God or to follow the current of what was going on at that time. And we see that as the story develops, we see how these men stood firm and said, "No, King, we will not bow before any of these, before this great statue. We will only worship our God." And we find ourselves in chapter 3 of the book of Daniel. And in verse 19, after Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stand firm in their beliefs towards the Lord, man, the king is furious. And he says, in verse 19, he says, "Then Nebuchadnezzar was full of fury, and the expression on his face changed towards Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He spoke and commanded that they heat the furnace 7 times more than it was usually heated. And he commanded certain mighty men of valor who were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning furnace." I can only imagine at this moment what was going through these guys' minds as they're watching these men go out and start to heat up this fire. Now, I don't know how many of y'all have a stove furnace in your home or a chimney in your home, and when it gets cold, you know, you want to stock it up and get it all warmed up, and sometimes, you know, it's nice and cozy, and then sometimes it can get too hot and you're just kind of like, ugh, you know, in the middle of your living room. But I can only imagine what these guys were going through watching this furnace being, you know, heated up 7 times. You know, how much can you stand firm in what you believe when you see what's going to happen to you and you're standing in front of it? And here the king says, throw them in. And they tie them up and they throw them in. But they didn't just throw them in. It was so hot that the guys that threw them in got burnt. I can imagine, you know, being bound like that, I would have been clenching and closing my eyes and then thrown in the water and being like, ah! As I was falling into the burning fire. But the awesome thing was at that moment, you know, their trust was in God. And to see what God did to them, as they fell, the fire burns their ropes and they're free. They get up, they're walking around, and they turn around and they see the Son of God standing in the midst of them. The promise of God watching over us is amazing at that moment. The promise that God will take care of us is amazing. And there they were in the midst of that fire, but they were with God. To the point where the king declared afterwards that every man and woman and child, every human being that could breathe in his kingdom should worship the one true God. It's an amazing story. Pray at this moment. Dear Jesus, we love you for who you are. We worship you and praise you for who you are. You are a mighty God, and there is nothing that could be said differently. We've seen time and time through the history of Christianity, through the history as we study the Bible, that your protection is over us, your guidance is over us, and no matter what is in front of us, Lord, you are greater, you are powerful, and you control it all. We praise you and worship you, Lord, for the great God you are. And we thank you for your love towards us.
If you would stand with us this morning, listen to what God's word has to say. It says, Lord, you have been our refuge in every generation. Before the mountains were born, before you gave birth to the earth and the world, from eternity to eternity, you are God. Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you healed me. You are my shelter and my shield. I will put my hope in you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart, my portion forever. I want you to look on the screens. We're going to sing a new little chorus this morning. It talks about his goodness, his protection, and being our shield. Join us as we sing this morning.
I will bless the Lord forever. I will trust him at all times. He has delivered me from all fears. He has set my feet upon a rock.
strong tower, my very present help. You are my shield, my strength, my portion, deliverer, my shelter, strong tower, my very present help in time of need.
There is only one person that can make that promise to be our shield and our portion. And that is a great God that we serve. Join us this morning as we sing the splendor of the King. How great is our God.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. All the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the light. The Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, we'll see how great. How great is our God.
Then sings my soul.
Then sings my soul. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, we'll see how great. How great is our God.
Lord, we thank you for being our portion, our shield, and our defender. Lord, we thank you for being an incredible, great God. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
find a remarkable story in Luke chapter 23, verses 32 and 33, and verses 39 through 43. The Bible says there were also two others, criminals, led with him to be put to death. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right hand, the other on the left. Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, "If you are the Christ, save yourself and us." But the other answering rebuked him, saying, "Do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Assuredly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." What we have tried to portray to you today is the fact that God protects His own. Those who call on the name of the Lord are under the protection of Almighty God. And as we watch and we see the stories that are presented from the Word of God and we read these passages, then we get a clearer understanding of how God time and time again protects His own. But please let me jump to the opposite side of this discussion for just a moment. Because I want you to see that there are actually two very incredible misunderstandings regarding God's protection that we need to learn. If you haven't already, this is the perfect time for you to come into a new understanding about God's protection. The first is that some people believe that God's protection, when they come to Christ, means that they no longer are under the consequences of their sin. You know, the story I read just a minute ago is a great illustration that that is not true. Now certainly the consequences of our sin when we come to Jesus Christ are taken away in that we no longer face the wrath and judgment of Almighty God. We no longer have on us the thought that we will spend eternity in the lake of fire. Certainly the wrath of God has been satisfied with what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary. But it is not the case that if I sin against God, I engage in activities that are outside the will of God, that I have sowed something that will eventually come up and I will face those consequences. The thief on the cross is a very good illustration of that, as I said. Yes, he did turn to Jesus Christ in his last hour. He said, "Will you remember me?" In other words, you're the only way that I have of escaping eternal punishment. Will you remember me when I come into your kingdom? Jesus said to him, today you will be with me in paradise. But while his eternal destiny was changed, it did not change the fact that he was still hanging on a cross. It did not change the fact that he would die for the crimes that he had committed while in this world. You see, God chooses to give us the opportunity to enter into His family. And He says, now submit to my will, submit to my spirit. And if you submit to my spirit, then the Holy Spirit of God is going to begin to produce fruit in your life. But if you bypass God's will, and if you bypass God's direction, and you begin to pursue your own direction, you begin to follow after your own desires, the Bible says that we are sowing to the flesh. And when the seed is sowed in the ground, it always comes up. Very few times do we find God protecting us from the consequences or the results of our sin. And unfortunately, reaping the results of our sin is very painful. Many of us can attest to the pain and the suffering that it's caused, not only in our lives, but in the lives of many others. I've seen families that were broken because of impurity and immorality. I've seen families that have been broken apart, and even though they've come back to Christ and they've come back to God, and maybe the family's been restored, there is still the pain and the agony of the sin that was committed. Please understand me when I say, we will never face, once we come to Jesus Christ, the sin. But the consequences here on earth are still real. God's protection does not always afford us coverage for those things that we've done. We will reap what we have sown. The second thing we find in the Word of God that is a misunderstanding regarding God's protection is that God's protection, when we come to Christ, will somehow protect us and shield us from anything bad ever occurring again. Certainly we know this is not true. Jesus Himself said, in this life, you will have tribulation. You're going to have problems in this life. That's what life is all about. And yet sometimes we get in our minds, we get in our thoughts that if I can just become part of the family of God, then all of that will go away. I believe if you were to talk to Daniel before he went into the lion's den, he would tell you, you know what, the problems of this life have not gone away. I believe if you could have talked to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego before they were thrown into the furnace, they would have told you, you know what? The problems of this life have not gone away. Yes, I have faced some circumstances that have been very difficult, even being part of God's family. This is one of those things that is actually beyond our understanding. Because there are times when we try to understand why things are happening. But God, I'm following you. God, I am your servant. God, I'm faithfully doing what you've called me to do. And yet, I'm suffering. Was it not true of Jesus that he was faithful in everything God asked him to do? Was it not true of Jesus that he was the only perfect person to ever have lived? And yet, he suffered and was treated as an animal. Then how can that be God's protection? It is only an eternal God. It is only the God who knows the beginning and the end. It is only God who knows what the pieces of the puzzle are supposed to look like. It is only God who knows how my life is to fit into the puzzle that can actually say if this is protection or not. When I go through something hard and I go through something very difficult in my life and I begin to say, God, where's your protection? It may be that God in His unlimited knowledge is saying, you don't know what I'm really protecting you from. You really don't have a clue what this is doing to protect your family. You really have no insight into what I'm doing here to bring about something wonderful in your life. And therefore, we as simple, common, limited humans must say, okay, God, I don't understand it. I don't really like it. It hurts. But I trust you enough to know that all things work together for those who love you, those who are called according to your purpose. You know, when we're sitting in an auditorium and we're protected from a lot of the things that are going on outside the doors of our church, and we're shielded maybe from the insults and the harassment of people who would typically be doing that in our lives, it's easy for us to say, all things work together. But when the pain is real, and the suffering is real, it's much more difficult, isn't it? Could we not condition our minds and condition our thoughts and grow in our knowledge of God enough to where we could believe this without any hesitation, despite the darkness of the day and the darkness of the hour? Could we get to the place where we could say, God does all things well. All things. The good, the bad, the ugly. It's always right. Certainly it is true that God protects His children. But it is also true that that protection is only found in Jesus Christ. Therefore, if you do not know Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are not under the umbrella of God's protection. As the criminal on the cross found, the only way to bring about eternal life was in Christ alone. As Jason comes, let's just sing that song now.
Stand with me if you would. In Christ alone, my hope is found. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What a heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No.
of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he turns and calls me home here in the power of Christ. I'll stand.
If you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today is the day for you to get assurance of that. Can I invite you, as the choir and as Jason continue to sing here in just a moment, if you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you do not stay out from under the protection of Almighty God, but that you just quietly move from your place, make your way to the aisle that is closest to you, and come to the front. Allow us to show you from God's Word how you can know Jesus Christ as your own Savior right now. Will you come? Will you come as the choir sings?
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, from through the fiercest drought and storm, what heights of
seated. Hey, would you take your connection card out, please? In your bulletin, there are two things that were inserted. One is your connection card. This really means a lot to us. If you would please take time during the course of final moments of our service and fill this card out for us. On the back side of the card, there's a couple of things you can do. If you feel God leading you into a relationship with Him and you'd like to know more about that, the top left-hand side of your card, there's a box that's titled My Next Step Today. And right below there, you can request information about becoming a follower of Jesus Christ. If you'll check that box, here's what I'll do. Tomorrow, I'll stick a couple of small, easy-to-read books in the mail to you that will help you understand. I will not call your name. I will not embarrass you, not have you stand up in church. That's not what this is about. But just simply introducing you to Jesus Christ and His plan for salvation. If you'd like to have that, if you'll check it, then we'll get that out to you tomorrow. You can also request other information from the church. One thing specifically I would like for you to write on this card. Please listen to this. If there's something that you've been maybe questioning about the Scriptures, maybe you don't understand it fully or you'd like to know more about it, something that's specifically been on your heart recently, would you please indicate that on the card? If it's baptism, write down baptism. If it's salvation, write down salvation. If it's being filled with the Holy Spirit, whatever it may be, if you'll write that down, I'm going to begin a series of messages that deal with things that we struggle with, things that are hard for us to understand. And I would like to know maybe something that's difficult for you to where I can include that in to the discussion. If you'll please do that. And then, in just a moment, the offering plate's going to come in front of you. If you would, please just fold the card up to protect your information and drop it in the offering plate as it passes by. You also find inside your bulletin one of our faith promise cards. On Wednesday evening, if you were in the service, you know that we've already completed this. But in our faith promise, it's simply this. We've been dealing with the matter of missions and giving and getting our sent missionaries back to the field, getting them to an acceptable level of support. If you feel that God's leading you to do that, if you will indicate on this card the amount per month that God is leading you to give over what you already give to missions, then that would be greatly helpful. Now, this is not meant for it to be, let me think how to say this. It's not meant as anything other than a faith promise. What I'm saying is, God, I do not have the money you're calling me to give to missions, but as you provide it, I'm going to give it. So then you may feel God leading you to give $100 a month, and yet right now you're living in a deficit. If that deficit continues, God's not providing for you to give, so you don't give. It is a faith promise. God, as you provide, I will give. So then if you feel God leading you to do that, if you would please indicate on this card, you can keep half of it for yourself or a portion of it for your own records. Put the other part into the offering plate when it comes by. We do not want your name on this, but we would appreciate the Sunday school Bible study class you're in. If you're in the builder's class, Dr. Wolf is the teacher, you can put either the teacher or the class. If you're not in a class, then obviously just leave that blank. That's not a problem. And then if you will, please put that in the offering plate. Just a couple of quick things that I want to mention to you. One is just a little typo on our bulletin. It says that the cost for the CPR class, which is beginning tomorrow, is $10. It's actually $25. $25 for the class. Every penny of that is for the class itself. You obviously know how we work. We don't make money on things like that. But that begins tomorrow. The phone number for Karen Wolf is in the bulletin. If you have questions about it, you can give her a call. She'd be glad to answer those for you. Then the second thing I wanted to tell you about is the way our mission conference came out. How incredible we are. Oh my goodness. I've heard many of you say, and I feel this way myself, that this is our best mission conference yet. God really blessed as we sacrificially gave to our missionaries. And our sent missionaries, Daniel and Stephen Arcee, along with Jim and Linda Butler, they went home with a check for $3,500 apiece So praise the Lord. Thank you so much for giving to God. And for providing for our missionaries. Second part of this is on top of that, we also gave to the children $120. And I was blessed beyond words that evening when I received a little clip of a video in the mail that I hope to have for you later on, maybe in an expanded format as we have time. We weren't sure how much time we were going to have today. But a little clip of the RC children opening up their envelope, and how one of them said on the video that, I hate to spoil this, because it may come in the video next week or whenever we get to show it, but he said, tomorrow, this was on Wednesday, tomorrow was my first day of soccer practice, and my soccer cleats had holes in them, and then we were going to be playing out in muddy water. And he said, now I have the money to buy a new pair of soccer cleats. Wow, that was such a blessing. Thank you so much for giving, being part of what God is doing through missions at Mile Straight. You are such a blessing to me. You've been such a blessing to our missionaries, to our speaker as well. Well, let's receive our offering. Father, today we have watched how you protect those who belong to you. We've seen the very positive side of it. We've also seen the things that we misunderstand about it. But all in all, I pray that we have grown in our knowledge of who you are today. I pray, Father, that you will continue to bless our missionaries. We're so grateful for the opportunities you give us to give to them, to help them, to send them to places where we can't go so that they can do what you've called us to do there, as well as what you've called them to do there. I pray, Father, for your blessings to be over this offering. And I pray that you'll bless in behalf of our church family, particularly for Tom and Diane McCombs now as they're on their way to Ohio to attend the funeral of his mother. I pray, Father, that you'll just encourage them, that you'll strengthen them, that they'll know that they have a church family back home that is praying for them. And Father, for the details of Diane's physical condition as she needs to have dialysis in Ohio, I pray that you'll work that out as well for her. Such a difficult situation, but it's nothing for you. So we give you all of this now and ask you to handle it. Bless now in this offering. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Several people are working hard right now in our Fit Together program in order to get in shape. If you want to find out more about getting involved, there are a couple of ways that you can go about doing that. If you want to find out more about our circuit training course, the class we have every Saturday morning at 8:45 in the gym, you can see Krista Goss or Jennifer Duke right after the service this morning. If you'd like to find out more about the P90X class every Tuesday and Thursday up in the youth room, you can see Pastor Tom after the service this morning. This year, Easter takes place a lot earlier than it usually does, so make sure you mark the dates of all of our Easter events on your calendar and be prepared for them. First, on a week from this Saturday, March 23rd at 3 p.m., we're going to have our annual Easter egg hunt. Then on March 31st, Easter Day, we're going to have a very special service here in the auditorium. Make sure you mark these dates down and invite somebody to be with us for our Easter events this year. With the coming of the Easter season, we have another incredible opportunity to be involved in an intense Bible study from David Platt, the author of the book Radical. It's called Secret Church, and it's going to take place on Good Friday, March 29th from 7 p.m. to 1 a.m. This in-depth study is going to take place in the auditorium, and it's going to be on heaven, hell, and the end of the world. You can find out more about the Secret Church Bible study at the Welcome Center after the service.
Well, I was expecting one more thing to happen, but it didn't, so we'll just move on. Hey, listen, one thing to keep in mind, and that is that our partners in ministry today is Pilgrim's Rest Baptist Church. Aaron Britt is the pastor, and our missionaries sent missionaries from our church that are partners in ministry are Daniel and Lucy Arcee and their children. Please be praying for these partners as they serve God, that God will use them abundantly and will meet their needs. And then also, and finally, before we're dismissed, let me remind you, make sure you're back this evening. 6:30, Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. Please don't miss the services. And please be praying for Tom and Diane McCombs. As I mentioned in my prayers, Mom passed away. They're on their way to Ohio for that. All right. Thank you so much for being here. Make sure you're back this evening at 6:30. You're dismissed.